गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल ऑफ यू। सो टुडे वी विल स्टार्ट विद अ न्यू चैप्टर साउंड। इन दिस चैप्टर द फॉलोइंग कंटेंट्स दैट वी आर गोइंग टू कवर, फर्स्ट साउंड एज अ फॉर्म ऑफ एनर्जी, देन प्रोपगेशन ऑफ साउंड, द टर्म्स विच आर रिलेटेड टू साउंड वेव, रिलेशनशिप बिटवीन टाइम पीरियड एंड फ्रीक्वेंसी, हाउ टू रिप्रेजेंट अ वेव। देन वी विल डिस्कस characteristics of sound. There are few characteristics of sound that we will discuss: loudness, pitch and quality, the factors which affect the loudness of the sound, and how to change the pitch in different musical instruments. So let's see first of all sound. So in the previous chapter we have studied about the heat is a form of energy that gives us sensation of cooling or heating of the body. Similarly, in case of the sound, it is a form of energy that gives us sensation of hearing in our ears. So suppose a sound is produced, then in that way we are able to hear the sound, and we are able to hear it because of the sound energy. Now the question arises, how the sound is produced? In case of sound, it is always produced due to the vibration. So what is a vibration? Vibration is a to and fro motion of the body about its mean position. Suppose here in this figure you can see a string has been tied between the two fixed nails. Now when you displace this string, what happens? The particles of the string is going to vibrate about its mean position. Suppose if you concentrate on this particle, then this particle is going to move in to and fro motion about this mean position. So this is known as vibration. As soon as the vibration is produced, the sound is produced. As soon as the vibration stops, the sound also stops. So we can say that only the vibrating objects produces the sound. Now how the sound reached to our ears? You can see here a vibrating object is compressing the particles nearby, particles of the air. These particles of the air transport the energy to the other particle, and in the same way energy is transferred from one particle to the another particle. So we can say that the sound is produced by the transfer of energy from one medium particle to the another with the help of the vibration. For example, let's take a very familiar example of the loudspeaker. You must have noticed whenever you switch on the speaker, the diaphragm of loudspeaker cone moves forward and backward, due to which what happens, the air near to it compresses and the sound is, and the particles nearby to this air transport the energy from one particle to the another, and hence that sound reaches the eardrum, and in the eardrum the combination of the three bones starts vibrating, and hence the sound has been heard by our ears. So this is how the sound is produced, and this is how the sound is transferred from one point to another point. Now next is, sound needs a medium for its propagation. So suppose if you take a solid medium, then sound can easily transfer. In liquid or gas medium also the sound can easily transfer, but as we have seen in the previous examples, the sound is actually transferring from one point to the another point by the transfer of energy from one particle to the another. That means to transfer the sound, the medium must contain the particle. So if there is no medium, for example if you take a vacuum, so we already knew in vacuum it is not a medium, it does not contain any particle. So let us suppose a jar is there which contains a bell. So when the bell rings, you are not able to hear the sound. Why? Because there are no particles in the medium, and there are no particles, so there is no propagation of the sound. So that means sound needs a medium for its propagation. Now next thing is, how the sound travels in a medium. The sound travels in the medium in the form of the waves. So you can see here in this diagram, as soon as the dog starts to bark, the vibration is moving from one point to the another and it can be heard by the another person. So this is how we can represent the sound. It can be represented in the form of wave. We will discuss these waves in detail in the later slides. So this is the maximum displacement that we called as loudness. Then this is, see, from here to here you can see the wave is again repeating. So we can say that sound can be represented in the form of the wave. Next, one of the familiar example to see how the sound is produced, or to demonstrate how the sound is produced. When the tuning fork is struck, the prongs of the fork begins to vibrate. So this is the tuning fork and these are the prongs of the tuning fork. When this is struck with the help of a rubber pad, they will start to vibrate. Now, movement of speed of sound waves depend on the medium in which sound waves travel. Definitely, so sound travels fastest in solids, little slower through liquids and slowest through the gases. So what actually is taking place? When the prong of the vibrating tuning fork moves towards right, it pushes and compresses the air in front of it, creating a region of high density and high pressure. So this is the region of high density and high pressure. It is compressing the air. This region is called compression. Next is, when the prong of the tuning fork moves towards left, suppose it is moving towards left, the air in front of it expands and creating a region of low density and low pressure. This region is called rarefaction. So here you can see the particles are apart a distance from each other and appreciable distance is there. So this region is called rarefaction. So sound travels in the form of compression and rarefaction in the given medium. Here we can see, when the prong moves towards the left, the air is going to expand. When it moves towards the right, air is going to compress. So this is the combination of a rarefaction and compression. This is how that sound travels in the medium. And this is one compression and one rarefaction together constitutes the one wave. This compression we called as crest and this depression we called as trough. So the wave in which particles of the medium vibrate to and fro or back or forth along the direction of propagation of wave is called longitudinal wave. So we can say that sound waves are longitudinal waves. As you can see in this diagram, as soon as the sound is produced, the air near to it got compressed and then it is a rarefaction, then the compression, the air expands, then it compressed, and in this manner the energy from one particle is transferring from the other particle through the particles of the air. So the particles of medium is actually vibrating to and fro or back or forth along the direction of propagation of wave. So that is why sound waves are known as the longitudinal wave. Now, few terms related to sound waves. First is amplitude. Amplitude is the maximum displacement of the particles of the medium from their original undisturbed positions when the wave passes through the medium is called the amplitude. So amplitude is used to describe the size of the wave. Since it is the displacement of the particles of the medium, so its SI unit is meter and sometimes it is also measured in centimeters. Next term is time period. Time period is the time required to produce one complete wave or cycle. It is denoted by the letter T, and hence since it is the time, so its SI unit is second. Next is frequency. Now time period is the time taken by the wave to complete one oscillation, but frequency is number of oscillations produced by the wave in 1 second. For example, if 10 complete waves or vibrations are produced in 1 second, then the frequency of waves will be 10 hertz or 10 cycles per seconds. The frequency of the wave is generally denoted by the letter small f, and the SI unit of frequency is hertz, or sometimes the bigger unit of frequency is also used, which is known as kilohertz, and 1 kilohertz is equal to 1000 hertz. Next term is wavelength. The minimum distance in which a sound wave repeats itself is called its wavelength. That is, it is the length of one complete wave, and it is denoted by the Greek letter lambda. The distance between the centers of two consecutive compressions or two consecutive refraction is equal to its wavelength. So this is how we can define the wavelength of the wave. Since again it is a distance, so its SI unit will be meter, and sometimes it is also measured in centimeters. Now there is a relationship between the time period and the frequency. Time period is actually inverse of frequency, or we can say frequency is inverse of the time period. So as the frequency increases, the time period decreases. That means as the number of waves completing in per second increases, that means the time period for the completion of one wave always is also decreases. So here we can summarize everything in this diagram. The oscillation, that is the one complete to and fro motion where one full wave is constituted. The wavelength, as we have discussed, the minimum distance that the wave take to complete one oscillation. So the wave starts from this point A and it is going to point C. So this distance AC is known as the wavelength. Next was the amplitude. Amplitude was the maximum displacement of the medium particles, or more loud the sound is, more is the amplitude of the sound. Then the time period, the time taken by the wave to complete one oscillation. So from A to C, this green wave shows one oscillation. So whatever time the wave takes to complete this one oscillation is known as a time period. And number of these type of oscillations completed by the wave in 1 second is known as the frequency. Now how the wave is represented? Wave is represented by two methods. First is displacement time graph. Now in this graph, displacement of one particle on the wave varies with the time is displayed. That means if you choose a particle of the wave, and if you want to see the displacement of that particle with respect to time, in that case we are using the displacement time graph. Now if you want to see the movement of all the particles of the wave, in that case we uses the displacement distance graph. Here you can see on the y-axis displacement is there, on the x-axis distance has been represented. So this is how we can represent the sound wave. So a displacement distance graph shows how the displacement of all the points on the wave varies with time. Next is characteristics of sound. So these are the few characteristics of sound. First is loudness. It distinguishes between loud and feeble sound. That is, how much a loud sound is loud or how much the sound is faint, that is not hearable. It mainly depends upon the amplitude of the sound. More is the amplitude, more is the loudness. Other factors are also there which affect the loudness, like area of the vibrating body, distance of the listener from the source. This we will discuss in the later slides. Next will be the pitch. Pitch distinguishes between shriller and flatter sound. So the voice of a male and female can be easily distinguished because the voice of the female is shriller and the voice of the male is flatter. So how to distinguish between the two voices? It is by the help of the pitch, and it mainly depends upon the frequency of the sound. higher is the frequency, shriller is the sound, and shorter is the wavelength. Next characteristics is quality. It distinguishes the quality of the sound having the same loudness and same pitch. So the quality is actually used whenever you want to differentiate between the sound of different type of musical instruments. So now we will discuss these characteristics of sound one by one in the next week. For now, thank you.